Welcome, everyone. As we begin tonight, let us first take a moment to begin with a prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we come before you, standing here when it's still ordinary time. But on Wednesday, we will celebrate Ash Wednesday and begin our season of Lent. It is a season that we are used to, and we kind of know the rules about it, but sometimes we follow those rules without necessarily thinking about them or thinking about the significance of them. Help us in our discussion tonight to think about what they really mean for us so that we may actually do them in a meaningful way, in a way that helps us grow to be your more faithful disciples. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A couple informational words before we begin. If you've been to my two previous presentations here, it was basically all lecture. I'm doing a little bit of different format for two reasons tonight. One, as we talk about Lent, probably most of the stuff we'll talk about tonight, you're all familiar with in some way. So it's not all new. So I figured it might be able to make it be a little bit more of a Q&A or discussion than be standing up here and lecturing. The other part of why I can do things differently tonight, if you notice, the equipment around me is a little bit different than the previous presentations. We just got this TV, which is hooked to my computer to do slides. So that kind of changes the dynamics of how we can do this. So with that, I do have an evaluation form at the end, and so an evaluation form, at least one of the questions is, how do you like the change in format? Because the very last slide, if you hit read the bulletin, there's two more presentations coming up, and I'm still deciding how I'm going to work them as far as lecture versus discussion and whatnot, and using the slides and that. But the last handout I gave you that you weren't supposed to look at before you finished your quizzes is the copy of all the slides I will use. So there'll be some of the slides where the words get a little small because there's a lot of information on them. That's why you have copies of the slides. But if you're like me, even the slides sometimes get a little small to read the text, so then I suggest a magnifying glass, which is what I do sometimes too. So we're here to talk about our Lenten practices tonight, and the way we're going to do this is kind of go through the questions that are on the sheets. So the first question is, what comes to mind when you hear the word Lent? And this is where on this side we have technology. On this side we have marker and paper. So what comes to mind, did you say, when you hear the word Lent?
Stations.
Sacrifices. I started like stations of the sacrifice. Sacrifice. And let me turn around so you can hear it again. I should mention the video camera is also rolling. Given the different format, I'm not sure if it's going to work out to use it. If it turns out nicely, that will be on the website afterwards too, but given the different format, I don't know how it's going to work. So station, sacrifice.
Fasting.
And don't be looking at the slides on the paper at this point. I heard somebody say something over here. Hmm?
Preparation.
Huh? Preparation. Will you listen to what your mother is saying?
No, you listen to what she's saying.
Examination.
Any others?
Alms to the poor. Do we still we have that box?
Alms.
Looking forward to Easter.
Looking forward to Easter.
Anticipation.
Yeah.
I'm discovering I don't like the tip on these markers. Although, I should just be happy it's legible, because I'm a lousy handwriter, I'm writing on a board that's moving as I do it, and I'm left-handed, which makes it challenging not to get it all over my hands. Anything else?
Prayers.
Prayers.
Miss?
Penance.
Rosary?
That's, actually, if you, when you look ahead at the slides, you're writing down things I didn't think of. Rosary is not something I would think of. You said it right after penance. So. Do you think the rosary is penance? It can be. I can give that.
Yeah. I think I've been given it.
What did you do? I thought we just said a couple of our fathers. So.
Well, fair enough. You can do all
things. Anything else?
Sadness.
Sadness?
That makes me think about Good Friday and Easter. How about opportunity?
See, the list here of combined minds is longer than the list of the pastor here. Of course, that's in part because I didn't think of all these things, but since I printed, made the copies of the slides, I thought of more, but since I had already printed the slides, I wasn't about to change anything. But the idea of the collective mind is why sometimes we need to start learning is to talk about our faith with other people, because we all sometimes know different things, think about it from different perspectives. So, compared to the list, you guys had, I also had ashes, which we'll talk about in a RSIA, because we have various rites going on, and then at the end of Lent, when we celebrate the Easter Vigil, those people receiving their sacrament. The first two probably are both in my mind, because as I wrote this presentation, I was like, oh, we have ashes, we got to get ashes to the terrace, we got to get ashes to the Newark Manor, and then RCA, we're also planning for those rites now and figuring out what to do it. So that's where my mind is at as I do these things. Stations, we'll talk about more in a moment. Giving up something. When we get a couple slides into it, we're going to talk about much of this, with the idea of sacrifice and fasting. Is here. Abstaining from meat. If you're a vegetarian, that one's no big deal. If you're me, that's a huge deal. Fasting, almsgiving, prayer. So we'll talk about some of these. If we don't get to all of these, if you want to ask questions about them, please do so. So turning to the ones I thought about, because that's the ones I have slides made for. Comes to mind when you hear the word Lent? We have ashes. And we know we come on Ash Wednesday, and we get ashes. If you come in the morning and then you go to work or wherever afterwards, and somebody tells you your forehead's dirty. Where I used to work for the DFT, some of the guys would go out for lunch, and they'd come back, and they'd have their ashes on their forehead, and then the other half of the Catholics in the building would say, oh, it's an Ash Wednesday? I guess I got to go to Mass on my way home. So we still use ashes today, but to think about what those ashes symbolize, because it is not just about having ashes on our forehead. They symbolize something. And it's not just a Christian symbol. If you go all the way back to Genesis, the book of Genesis with Abraham, chapter 18, 27, Abraham says, see how I am presuming to speak up to my Lord, though I am dust and ashes. You know, in that sense, the ashes is a sign of humility, that we are nothing. without God. God forms us into what we are. So the ashes are a sign of humility. And then as we people are, the Israelites are being led out of Egypt towards the promised land, God begins to give them instructions about the sacrifices to make. And in Numbers 19, verses 1 to 10, it speaks of sacrificing the heifer. And it spells it out somehow to sacrifice that thing. And it says, then you burn the heifer and you keep the ashes for the purification water. So the ashes came from the sacrifice of the animals, the burnt sacrifice. And why were those animals sacrificed?
To come
what?
For God.
To God. What did it? Why did they sacrifice the animals? It's not just to come up with the ashes. Most of the sacrifices prescribed in the Old Testament are associated with for the forgiveness of sins. So they burnt the animal as a part of the offering. They kept the ashes as a reminder of that burning sacrifice on it. And then the ashes, then they put on ashes as a symbol, say, I'm a sinner. I need forgiveness and I need God's mercy. So we see this in the book of Judith. And Judith, I will say, in my next talk is on the Bible, we'll talk about this type of thing more. You may be familiar that our Catholic Bible has more books in it than the Protestant Bible. The book of Judith is one of these. So if you're talking to a Protestant and say, well, Father says in the book of Judith, and they look at you funny, it's because they may not have a book of Judith in their Bible. But it does talk about the sacrifices here, and it talks about them fell prostrate themselves in front of the temple and sprinkled ashes on their heads, spreading out their sackcloth before ashes, before the Lord. And putting it on as a set symbol of their penitential, their contrite hearts, and that. And then Matthew 11:21, Jesus says, woe to you, Chorazin, woe to you, Bethsaida, for if the mighty deeds done in your midst had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would long ago have repented in sackcloth and ashes. So Jesus himself says, you know, this is a good symbol of our sorrow. So when you come forth on Ash Wednesday to get the ashes, you are saying, I'm not perfect. I've committed sins. And I'm willing to admit that. This does not count as confession, though. But it does count as a sign of it. And on Ash Wednesday, if you pay close attention, normally at any other Mass, we begin after the sign of the cross, and I greet the people, we have the penitential rite, Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. On Ash Wednesday, we don't have that penitential rite, because then we do the readings, and then the homily, and then we do the distribution of ashes. And the ashes take the, even though it's at a different point in the Mass, take the place of that penitential rite. Because, you know, when we do that penitential rite, I say, let us acknowledge our sins so as to prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. So when we do that, we're acknowledging our sins. And when we come forth for ashes, we're acknowledging our sins. And we continue to do that today as a sign of our ashes. Our sinfulness. Yeah. Thank you. Does anybody know where the ashes come from today? Or they can also come from the catalog. But when they come from the catalog, they're still supposed to be burnt palms.
What about that part in the Bible that says, dust you are unto dust you will return? I thought that's what the ashes related.
Well, that's the same symbol. That would go back to not that this isn't the exact origin of that line, but see from what Abraham said, see how I am presuming to speak to my Lord that I am only dust and ashes. And part of that would probably go back to Genesis 2, but not in a literal way. When it says God formed Adam out of the, can I think which way it's, either says clay or from the ground. Relates to this dust image too. And it, there's two formulas that the person putting ashes on your forehead can say. One is repent and believe in the gospel. And the other, I don't remember the exact wording, which is why I say repent and believe in the gospel when I do it. It's something like that, but with the new translation, I think it may be slightly different. But it's that image of dust. We come from dust, we go back to dust. So again, but that whole idea that is we are nothing without God. Other questions about ashes? Stations of the Cross. A very common image of Lent. Of course, we can actually do them any time, but the time when we do them collectively as a church, you know, you see scheduled times for it, is Lent. Why do we do Stations of the Cross?
It's a memory lane.
Memory lane of what? It is.
Of Jesus' death.
Of what Jesus went through for us. And there's actually a tradition out there that says, even going back to the very early church, that Mary herself would walk the actual places of what we remember in the station. She would walk the actual way. By the 5th century, there's evidence of people who would go to Rome, or not to Rome, to Jerusalem, to make the stations. But when we say pilgrims, we're talking about people coming from Europe and that. And before there were planes, trains, and automobiles. So it would be a huge effort to do that. But not everybody could make that effort. I mean, even if you were rich, if you were supposed to be working or trying to maintain a farm or something, you wouldn't be gone a day or two to do this. You'd be gone probably weeks, if not months, to do this. So not everybody could do that. So somewhere along the line, they started seeing the stations or things like, not necessarily the stations as we know them today, but the precursors of it showing up in churches in Europe by the 5th century. By the 13th century, the Franciscans became the official custodians of the Holy Land, many of the sites there. And if you go to the Holy Land today, some of the sites there, the Franciscans are still the official keepers, maintainers of those sites. Or so I've been told, I've never been there. That's what they tell you if you go to the Franciscan Holy Land in Washington, D.C. They say, oh, and our order's the one that takes care of it. Question?
Why do you think there's only 14 or just 14?
Well, good question. Why is there 14? It wasn't until 1731 that there is 14. Before that, the numbers would fluctuate. Different people would do different numbers. There wasn't any prescribed number. It became 14. What's 14 divided by 2?
Seven.
Seven is an image of perfection in the Bible. I'm not sure in this particular case why they chose to double it. Can you double perfection? And that, but it is the reason it's 14 today. It is the double of seven being that perfect number. And it was only 1862 before these stations became something that could officially be done in all churches. Now we're used to, most churches you go today will have something hanging for stations. Like for us, we have actually images of the stations upstairs. If you go into the chapel, it's a much smaller image. It's a little more than a cross. Sometimes, especially in chapels, sometimes all it is 14 crosses. It's just a space and there. But with the idea of 14 is the traditional number. When we do Stations of the Cross on Fridays here in Lent, we'll be doing 14. There are some people today who will do 15 stations, and you can find it in a book, because the 14th station ends with Jesus in the tomb. Is that the end of the story?
No.
The 15th station, if they do one, is the resurrection. But so sometimes other times years, if I do stations myself, I might do the 15th station. But during Lent, to me, it seems one for the official number of 14, but two, it seems appropriate to stop at the 14th station, because everything we do in Lent is looking forward to Easter and the resurrection, but we're not quite there yet. So, Steve?
Is that Veronica's story, one of the stations with the towel open face?
Is Veronica's...
Is that one of the 14th?
Yes, it is.
Veronica White.
If you look, let me make sure I put it in the handout. Yes, the very last sheet of the handout is actually not a slide. This is a table I made up myself some years ago that lists the 14 stations as I am used to seeing and what I found various sources. You can find stations today that will list different ones, and actually, like even in Rome, for the Pope, there's a new set of stations that kind of mirrors the traditional, but sometimes differentiates more. So Veronica wiping the face of Jesus is number 6 on the traditional list that I have.
And there are no references.
But there's no, the table shows the 4 different Gospels. There are no references that specifically mention, especially anybody with, definitely with the name Veronica. It does have Jesus consoling the women in some of the Gospels. Veronica is not numbered.
So where does that come from?
It's from the tradition of the church. Any of these, even if there's no scripture passage, is a tradition of the church in the sense that we believe it. Some of it, they can find documents that say this happened. It's just not in the Bible. Other times, it's handed down by oral tradition by people that were here, because we know the Bible does not presume to write down every detail. We talk about Jesus being nailed to the cross. You know, part of that, we like the biblical references that make it explicit. When Doubting Thomas sees the risen Jesus, they specifically talk about the holes in their hand. So we know that means, although technically it actually wasn't in your hand, it was, and you got two bones. I think it's right here, you got two bones there, and they put it in between the bones. If you put it in your hand, you'll fall, your hand will tear apart, you'll fall off the cross. It adds to the pain.
Well, where is that veil? Seems like when I was a kid, thought that the veil turned out to be found years later, and now we've got famous veil.
Are you talking about the Shroud of Turin?
Yeah,
the Shroud of Turin. The Shroud of Turin is the last program I had seen where they talked about it. It dates to centuries after Jesus. And I think that's using techniques like carbon dating. The way the church looks at some of that stuff, the church, I believe it's positioned on the Shroud of Turin, it neither refutes it nor acclaims it. But with the testing, the church looks at those things and says, you know, well, what are you testing versus where's faith? Because there are scientists, and I don't know how they ever get the host to do this, they have tried to test consecrated host to see how it changes, and they can't find a change. But that's because the change doesn't happen on a physical level. So when they're talking about the day of the Shroud of Turin, physical evidence would say it's, I don't, if I had to guess, maybe 7th or 8th century. So 700 or 800 years after Jesus.
But then, what is the Shroud of Turin supposed to be of?
The Shroud, if it is original back to Jesus, is the cloth that Jesus was wrapped in when he was buried. And the image on it, then, is an image from Jesus. Other questions about the station? Any others? So looking at the next question on your handout, do we give up something for Lent? And I stumbled across this little guy and said, ooh, pick me, I'll do it. Don't we just love we give up something for Lent? Do we? We'll talk about why we give up in a minute, but do we actually have to give up something for Lent? We could actually add something to. You could add a devotion, like you could come to Stations of the Cross Fridays at 6 p.m., I believe. Double-check the bulletin on that. 6 p.m. And in that sense, if you think, well, we've got to sacrifice something. The sacrifice you're making is your time. You're giving up time where you would be doing something else. If you come to, I've been in some parishes where the first parish I was in, actually, I think the attendance at daily mass doubled during Lent. Because people would come to Lent at daily mass during Lent when they went the rest of the year. Or some people might just come one day a week because their work schedule does make it difficult. And then as Lent was getting near the end, I would always say to them, you can keep coming to daily mass after Lent's over. You know, we don't just do daily mass during Lent. You know, and in that sense, you know, Lent can be a time of changing our practices. It doesn't have to be something we just do for Lent. It's supposed to lead us to be better all the time. So, do we give something up for Lent? We don't have to give up, per se. We need to do something for Lent. So we talked about words that Lent means, and we sacrifice, the giving up, we'll get to, fasting, we'll get to. Preparation, we're looking forward to Easter. We'll talk about that actually a little bit later, I think. Examining ourselves, the penitential time. Well, actually, we had a slide about what color vestments I wear. Anticipating Easter, prayer, going to Mass, doing penance, rosaries. Again, the adding, if you don't pray a rosary the rest of the year, you can't get to stations or whatever, you can pray the rosary at home, and that can be your added thing. And then again, maybe you keep doing it after Lent is over. So, questions about any of these that you know you want to hear about? A couple more yet covered.
How should we deal?
Yeah, that's where we're going. It's one thing. What effect does Lent have on us? Particularly depending if we're giving up something, what are we giving up? So, how many people does Lent make you happy? Why? There is a reason why.
Well, I mean, usually whatever I give up, but, you know, I find out that, you know, I don't really need it. Mm-hmm. One year I gave up TV. It was awesome.
So. Does this count as giving up TV? Because at the next presentation I may use this. Yeah, but the next presentation during Lent I may. So you'll have to turn around a bit. with the happiness anticipating Easter. Sad? Why would it make us sad?
Thinking about what Jesus sacrificed for us.
What Jesus sacrificed for us. Blessed?
Yeah.
Same reason. Miserable. I think of people who give up coffee in their coffee addicts and they end up miserable the entire time. Although maybe they need to give up their coffee long term. But if they're only going to give up for Lent, I'm not sure it's a good thing. If they're going to give up forever, it might, over time, they might be.
I gave up cigarettes one year.
Giving up the cigarettes?
Yeah.
Well, see, that seemed like something you could give up and never go back to.
And I didn't, but I mean, it's true. Yeah. You are miserable.
Hungry. How many people will give up something for Lent that has to do with food? And you think about it. And then you get hungry. And then it becomes a real sacrifice. So, but the point isn't to feel hungry. And the point isn't necessarily to feel sad. It all should lead us to feel blessed. But if we're just doing these things, you know, especially you know, the kids sometimes, why do I have to give up something for Lent? If we don't understand why we're doing it, all the more it could make us sad or miserable. But if we understand why, then it's blessing.
Is it true that years ago when I was little,
I'll make no comment about that.
When we gave up something, it seems to me the priest told us that if we gave up candy, but you could eat it on Sunday, but it's okay to use Tuesday for Sunday, and then go.
Well, the Sunday question will come up later, but to say now, you, whatever you give up for Lent, you can do on Sunday. Sunday is a day of the celebrating the resurrection. It is always a day of joy. The Tuesday thing, I think, is stretching you a little bit.
Yeah.
Although,
Sunday.
Yeah, that isn't official rules.
Okay.
But with that, I will point out, and I think we've already put it in the bulletin, March 17th this year, St. Patrick's Day, falls on Friday. Be glad Bishop Montano is your bishop. I don't know why, since he's Italian.
I know.
But he's already granted a dispensation. So on St. Patrick's Day, you can celebrate. You can eat meat as part of a St. Patrick's Day celebration. It is not a day just to say, oh, good. I don't have to eat fish again. No, it's the idea of his granted dispensation is to celebrate St. Patrick's Day. But, and actually this is the point, I don't know if we put it in the bulletin for sure or not. He says in that same document where he letter where he gives permission to eat the dispensation, to eat meat on St. Patrick's Day. He says then I don't remember his exact wording, but he highly recommends a different day of the week. You don't eat meat. Because, and the way I look at it, if you just blow off that Friday and eat meat, because it's St. Patrick's Day, to me, if you do that with no disregard for it, don't think anything of it, you have now made St. Patrick more important than Jesus.
Yeah.
If you shift the days of the week, I don't think Jesus will get too upset. And by the way, also on St. Patrick's Day, if you think you should wear green because of Ireland and green, St. Patrick was a bishop of the Roman Catholic Church. During Lent, he would wear purple or violet officially. So he would not have shown up to a church function wearing green during Lent.
Why do you think St. Joseph doesn't get the same level of respect?
Have you ever talked to some Italians before?
This saint's day is on the 19th, right?
The 18th or 19th? I think the 19th or the 19th. The St. Patrick.
Dispensation for that day.
Actually, on St. Joseph's Day, you don't need a dispensation. St. Patrick's Day is a feast in the church. St. Joseph's Day, because he's foster father or adoptive father of Jesus. St. Joseph's Day is a solemnity. If you come to Mass on St. Joseph's Day, we will say the Gloria that we do not say the rest of Lent, except for when solemnities fall. Because it's considered high enough that it supersedes, isn't the right way, because Joseph is not more important than Jesus. But so if St. Joseph's Day falls on Friday, the dispensation about eating meat is automatic. St. Patrick's is only a feast. In our country, in the years of the formation of the country, there was, early on, I think there was more Irish than Italian. The Italians, my understanding is St. Joseph is a huge tradition. This Irish is St. Patrick's. So St. Patrick's shows up on secular calendars and all that. St. Joseph's Day doesn't show up on the secular calendars in the United States. But in the eyes of the church, St. Joseph would actually be a higher day because of his role as adopted father of Jesus. St. Patrick, very important, but ordinary human being. St. Joseph was human, but had a very specific role. So we try to be blessed. We may be hungry, although tonight you shouldn't be. And that. But these different days, but the Tuesday, the Sunday thing is right, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. The Tuesday thing, I think you're really stretching it. You know, it's like looking for tax loopholes. If we all just willingly stop looking for tax loopholes, we'd probably pay less in taxes. Or at least those of us who are honest would pay less in our taxes. If those who aren't would stop looking for loopholes. So now, to the question of why fast, why abstain from meat, why give something up? And with this idea of, like, why abstain, I think I mentioned before the idea if you're a vegetarian, it's not a big deal. I remember watching a deacon preach once when I was just starting out in seminary, and he was just old enough to remember when they went from where you couldn't eat meat year-round to just Lent. He was disappointed. He loved fish. So it was no real sacrifice. He loved the fish. He looked forward to Fridays. It's supposed to be a sacrifice. We're doing it on Fridays because Jesus died on Fridays. And if you go back to 1966, I believe it is, and you find where they changed the document where they changed the rules, and I don't do this like I should either. Friday year-round is supposed to still be a day of penance, where you're encouraged to give up something. But the rest of the year, you get to pick what it is. Without actually raising your hands, don't actually answer this question. How many people the rest of the year actually do something? It's penitential. The rule, everybody heard, oh, we can eat meat. Nobody heard the next paragraph. But it's the idea of doing something to say, God, you're more important to me than. So, you know, but they changed the rule with the idea, hey, we'll keep the no meat during Lent, so we're all doing the same thing, having some unity. But then throughout the year, the rest of the year, we'll encourage people to pick something that's a sacrifice for them. I have to admit, but I read that rule ever since. Now and then I think about the rule, and I'm like, I should come up with something. I'm like, I'm not eating fish every Friday, because if I eat fish every Friday, I actually get sick. I could do it some, but if I did it every week, at least I haven't found the right fish. Some are worse than others. But to be doing, always be doing something, and in that sense, everything we talk about, like for giving up, whatever, all of the things that go around Lent, we need to be thinking about throughout the year in some way. Lent is just a special time to focus on that. So we'll talk about why we even have Lent and if it's something some of the stuff that we could be doing year round. But before we get to there, why fast, why give up something? It is not primarily for punishment, although if we were all perfect, we wouldn't need Lent. But so there can be an element of penance in it, but it's not to be, or to be cruel. Jesus doesn't say give up something for Lent just to be mean to us. And then it's to show we put God first. You know, yesterday's homily talked about God, we cannot serve two masters, you cannot serve God and mammon. 1 Timothy 6:10, for the love of money, that is the root of all evil. Paul never said that money is the root of all evil. It's the love of money is all evil. So by willing to give something up, the whole thing is to say the money isn't more important. Because if we're not willing to give the money up at all, we're making the money more important than Jesus. And this next line is a quote, Matthew 6:24, from yesterday's gospel. God must have had a hand in this. This was put on the slide before I knew it was yesterday's reading. I actually made this slide up, and then a couple days later was talking to Jack Delbert, who writes our Prayers of the Faithful and that, and he was working on the ones for this weekend, and he said, so what do you, Father, do you think it should be this or that? I'm like, what's the reading? I looked at the reading. I said, I'm using that! So God's got this all coming together. So the giving up, developing discipline, in a sense, is again saying, I'm willing to do something for Jesus. And then to help us to become better people, both with what we give up or might go back to after Easter, again, just saying Jesus is more important, but also the things we give up, whether it's smoking cigarettes or whatever, if we don't go back to them, you know, or give up the bad habit that you don't want to go back to because it's a bad thing. And that, or sometimes you partially go back to it if you have the willpower. Sometimes it's all or nothing is better for willpower. I think like the TV. There can be good things to watch on TV. Today it probably can be easier at times to find bad things to to watch on TV. So you might give it up totally for Lent, but then go back to it afterwards, but in a more moderate way. Questions?
What about fasting and giving up at a certain age? Didn't they pass a rule on that?
Okay. Age question for fasting. Everybody from 14 and up is to abstain from meat, no matter what your age is. There is one qualification for that. I'll get into it in a moment. Everybody from 14 to 59 is to fast on Ash Wednesday, Good Friday. The reason those under 14 don't have to follow the rule, what are they doing? They're growing. So with the meat, they need protein to build those cells. And they need the energy, so in general, with fasting. When you get past 59, and I know nobody is there yet, the meat isn't a big issue to miss the meat for one day. But the fasting could trigger medical things. But I would say there, on the off chance you are past 59, and say you're in very good health, ask yourself, can you safely fast? You know, there are some people, actually Mike, if I fasted for, with the fasting rules we have, I can manage, okay. But if I really did the fast of eating nothing, it would throw my system out of equilibrium in a way that I would not enjoy. So, you know, if you're 70 and you have health problems, then you don't have to fast. But if your health is perfect, you know what your health is like. And besides, Jesus fasted. He did it for 40 days. And that's what actually this coming Sunday is the temptation of Jesus. So we'll hear about him fasting today. And when he fasted, it says he didn't eat anything for 40 days. We don't have to do that. Our fasting rules for those who do have fast today is one regular meal and two smaller meals. So actually some days for what I eat, that doesn't cut down the size of the table at all. It just cuts out all the snacks. There's nothing in between. So depending on what you eat, the fasting isn't necessarily a whole lot of difference. I do eat a little between meals. So with the fasting rules, though, that's the age part of it. It says, the other thing I was saying as far as the age goes, though, say you're 40, and the most common one would be, that I know of, could be a diabetic issue. You always eat what you need to for the diabetic. What you need to. Don't use it as an excuse to just say, I don't have to worry about the fasting, I'm a diabetic. No. You hopefully have some idea of how your body works, what it likes and dislikes. So you fast accordingly, you know, for whatever that means for you. I know some diabetics, they've got to eat, say at 8, 12, and 4, or whatever cycle they get, they've got to do that. If you've got to do that, you've got to do that. But you don't just forget about the rule. You say, is there a way I can honor this? And if there's not, maybe you think of something else you could do that day. Even if you're not giving up TV for Lent, could you give up TV that day or something? So you're saying, Jesus, I want to do something. And then we already talked about how adding something to them, if they're sacrificing time, or if you're giving alms in the sense of adding more, the giving up of whatever. Questions?
What's the best argument for the 9-year-old who knows the rules when you tell them that we're abstaining anymore?
What's the best argument for a 9-year-old?
Who knows the rules and you want to tell them that we're abstaining anyway?
If for a 9-year-old who knows the rules and says knows they don't have to follow, why should they? I think it still goes to you make the proper effort you can in that sense. That as some 70-year-olds could fast perfectly fine, it's the same thing for a 9-year-old. You wouldn't want them to fast completely, but they can make some effort. I mean, I know a guy when his kid, this is when the kid was like 9 or 10 years old, and the kid's probably now 25, so now I feel old. Because the parents were eating, were abstaining and whatnot, whatever was put on the table matched what they're doing. It's like, well, why do I have to eat this stuff? It's like, this is healthy enough you can do. It will get you the nutrients you need. So there, it's not that the kids can't do anything, but they can do what they're capable of. And if a family is vegetarian, especially, the vegetarians know how to still get the nutrients you need. So maybe that's the thing to think about with a kid. You say, you plan the meat quarterly. Those of us who are adults, sometimes the difference between a Friday in Lent and a Friday out might be you have meatless spaghetti in Lent, and on the rest of the year you do spaghetti with meat in it. But if you're doing the meatless all the time, and you just don't have the meat, you don't think anything of it. With a child, you make sure what you're eating gets them the nutrition they need. And I don't know if fish has protein in it per se, but fish has some of it. It must have some kind of protein in it. I don't know how different the level of it is.
And eggs.
And that. So there's ways to get. So you could say to them, we're making sure you get the nutrition you need. But you've got to make a deliberate effort in that with a kid versus just blowing it off. Question? Okay. Question for you now. When does Lent end?
Friday. The Mass of Holy Supper. Holy Thursday.
I'm hearing some Good Fridays. I'm hearing some Mass of the Lord's Supper. Is anybody else saying something else?
Holy Saturday.
Holy Saturday.
Wednesday.
Huh?
Wednesday.
Lent never ends? So you do the Friday every year round?
Saturday noon,
there is was an old rubric about something happened. I've heard it Saturday noon as far as the way things were celebrated. The correct answer for when Lent ends, and there's going to be an important distinction made here. Let me see what slide comes next. We're not quite there yet. Lent ends when the Mass of the Lord's Supper on Holy Thursday begins. When it begins. And this is, I stress the begin because I always used to, on Holy Thursday, we empty out the holy water fonts. I don't know how it's been here, but in other parishes, we always empty them after Mass. I think it was just last year in Ithaca. I happened to be reading the rubrics that morning of Holy Thursday. We're supposed to empty the fonts before Mass. Did they change this? Or were we just not doing it right? Because we're emptying them as we enter into the Triduum. The Triduum being Holy Mass, the Lord's Supper, Good Friday, Easter, begins with the Mass, the Triduum means 3 days, begins with the Mass of the Lord's Supper in the evening. Then Good Friday is part of the Triduum, and then we go into Easter. But it begins at the Mass of the Lord's Supper, not in the morning on Thursday. So Lent ends, that Mass normally always starts at 7 o'clock. With bishop's permission at time, some places does fluctuate a little bit depending on cultural situations. So Lent goes into that day.
And after Mass on Thursday night, don't you have to do some things on the altar?
After Mass is over on Holy Thursday, we de-decorate everything
that can. That seems like super Lent to me.
So, That idea of going into Good Friday, there is an element where you could say it's like super Lent. So, the Triduum, the 3 days are not referred to as a season. It's called Triduum 3 days, but the events we celebrate on Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and then into Easter are one event. We have 3 different services we go to. But if you come to Holy Thursday, and I encourage you to come to Holy Thursday, Not a lot of people do in parishes. I've been, I don't know. I haven't experienced it here yet. Maybe we're going. Many people don't. At the end of Holy Thursday, there is no blessing. At the end of the service on Good Friday, there is no blessing. And the reason is, Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and into Easter is one event. Yes, there's these long pauses in the service, but it's one event. The Holy Thursday Mass, it ends as a liturgical service, but it doesn't end per se. Holy Thursday, to understand Holy Thursday, you've got to have Good Friday. To understand Good Friday, you've got to have the resurrection. So they're one event. So there's no blessing, because they don't end in the same way a Sunday Mass ends. And that's why I highly encourage people to come to all three services.
So. I'm confused. Holy, when, serious.
Mm-hmm.
When do I go, or when do people go and pray until the church closes at midnight?
That's Holy Thursday.
All right.
We do Mass at 7 p.m.
Okay, yeah.
And then at the end of that, we
then
have a
we'll
procession,
watch, we,
a go around. And then the church is open to, this year at 11 o'clock, we'll do, anybody who's here at 11 o'clock, we'll do night prayer.
Yeah.
And then we go to bed.
Okay.
Some churches used to do it to midnight and whatnot. 10 o'clock is my bedtime, so I'll give you to 11, and then I got to lock in the church and go to bed.
Okay, I was.
If you came to 11 o'clock Mass, the Mass during the night on Christmas, at the beginning of Mass, I was somewhat cheery and whatnot. By time Mass was, if you talk to me after Mass, and then it took me another hour to get to sleep because my body was so screwed up about what time it was. It's like, are we supposed to go to bed now? I'm like, yes. And that. So Holy Thursday is the night. There'll be some kind of procession. And we put Jesus in the tabernacle, and then we sit and watch. And actually, some place, people will do the tradition where they'll go to different church.
Yeah.
I've heard it used to be as many as 12 churches some people would do. Now I hear 3 is a number more, because especially with fewer churches around and greater distance. If you live in Newark, it'd probably be a little difficult to get to 12 churches between 8:30 and midnight.
Right.
So Lent ends with the Holy Thursday. Don't forget the Holy Saturday thing yet, just yet. So, before we get into that whole 40-day thing, how are the dates of Easter and Ash Wednesday determined? Easter likes to move around, doesn't it?
Yeah.
The correct way to figure out when Easter is going to be in the future, right now, is you go on the internet and you type in Google or whatever internet search you use, dates of Easter for 2017 or 2018, and the internet will tell you.
Yes.
But how did they do it before the internet?
Right here, this quote that's on your slide. Easter follows a lunar rather than a solar calendar and is celebrated, Easter falls on the, and I'm not gonna read the quote exactly. The first Sunday after the first full moon after the spring equinox. Like I say, you go to Google and you type dates of Easter. The reason for this, if you remember right, remember, at the first Easter, everything happened at the time of the Passover. This has to do with how the Jewish calendar works. Now, it doesn't match exact. Some years when we have Easter, it's Passover's right at the same time. Other times it can be weeks apart. The Orthodox Church has a different way of determining Easter. So sometimes it's the same week. It's different. The good news with this, possible good news, is the Christian churches across the world, I think it's called the World Council of Churches, is talking about trying to find a common date for Easter. So like, I don't know what they're considering, but that would always be like the second Sunday in April. So you'd have be a little easier to figure out in the first Sunday after the first full moon after the spring equinox. And when I read this article a couple months ago now, I guess, surprisingly, but the Catholic Church is part of that discussion. I don't know if they will actually ever do it, because most Christian churches use this. already. So to change it after 2,000 years is a little... If we've done it this long, why do it? I don't know how likely it would be to change it. And if they did, I suspect, even if they decided they'd do it, they wouldn't do it for 3 to 4 years. Because calendars right now are already built. They may not all be printed, but things are set up. And on that, for the public, people who print the calendars, they're already... Next year's calendars are probably fully in their computers already, probably even a couple of years that they're working on. So the Easter's always the first full moon, the first Sunday after the first full moon after the spring equinox. Everybody got that? Okay. So, to get to Ash Wednesday, you would just count back 40 days, right?
No.
Doesn't work, does it? How many have tried? It is a 40-day period. But we'll get into why it's a little hard to count. But first, to stay in order of my slides, so make sure I cover everything. So why even have Lent? I mentioned RCA and the way I think about RCA with Lent. Lent started out, probably starting to take form by the 5th century. And the people who, they didn't call it RCA back then, who were coming into the church, and remember at that point the Catholic Church was the only Christian church. As they got close to Easter, the people teaching them, the catechists said, these people need a retreat, so to speak, right before Easter to get ready for it. So some of the early things talk about this time of retreat as being like just Holy Week. Others talked about periods of 3 weeks or 6 weeks and that. But then as this was forming, they're like, hey, you know what? This is probably good for all of us. We all need a little refresher. We all sin a little bit, right? Nobody in here sins, right? Confessions are Saturday, 3 to 4, by the way. So it developed into a time for everyone. But if for the people in RCA, for them, the special time will start on Sunday with the rite of election that we do next weekend with the bishop. Period of Enlightenment, is that the name of it?
It's
Mr. Goja,
right after.
Mr. Goja is after Easter. The Lenten time, once they do, from rite of election to the vigil. Now, the period of time is like a period, it's enlightenment, but there may be another word with it, I can't remember for sure. But it is a special time for them of finishing their final preparation. But for all of us, Lent is a time of thinking about how are we doing, what can we do better, and that. So it's a penitential time. But why did they settle on 40 days? Well, I mentioned this Sunday, we read the temptation of Jesus, that's Matthew 4, 1 to 11, and then Mark has a version, Luke has a version that we'll read in the years of B and C. Jesus goes into the desert and fasts for 40 days. If 40 days work for Jesus, anybody want to say you're too good for 40 days? So 40 days from there. Then you also have 40 days of rain with that great flood thing, which the story of the flood is Genesis chapter 6 to 9. But then these verses here in chapter 7, specifically with the flood, say raining for 40 days. And then Moses, with the story of Exodus, when he went up on the mountaintop and got the Ten Commandments, Exodus 24 and 34, specifically refer to him being on the mountain for 40 days. It's a biblical period of time. So if 40 days is good enough for Moses and Noah and Jesus, I think we can work with that. So, however, as I mentioned, is it the next slide? Yes. 40 days. It doesn't count out right. One part of it we've already talked about, in that the Sundays do not count. As far as Sundays being a time when you can have whatever you give up, sounds like cheating to me. If there's a need for you to have something during Lent, then Sunday may be the best time to do it. But to me, if you go ahead and have it every Sunday, you're not fasting for 40 days. You're fasting for 6 days, which is still something. Now, if you don't do it on Sundays either, then you actually end up doing it for 46 or 47 days.
If you don't count Saturday or Sunday, you have 40 days.
Oh, you do count Saturday. Saturdays count, but the trick is, here, I have Good Friday and Holy Saturday count for fasting. I said Lent ends on Holy Thursday. I didn't say the idea of that fasting. Good Friday, I hope we all know, is a day of fasting. Holy Saturday is a day of fasting, but in a different way than Good Friday. Holy Saturday, if you read the documents, talks about us still eating in moderation. It wouldn't be fasting like Good Friday, but you wouldn't have a smorgasbord on Holy Saturday. Although I've got the impression that somebody mentioned noon before on Saturday. There was some kind of tradition where things happened. There really was stuff that happened at noon. I've never experienced that myself to know.
You're not that old.
I'm 47.
It's wrong.
So when you count for 40 days, if you're looking for 40 days to fasting, if you count into Good Friday for sure and Saturday, if you think of the 40 days to get to 40 days, you count Friday and Saturday. It's just Lent. It's not Lent. But it is still a period of giving up. But technically, what you gave up for Lent on Good Friday, you don't necessarily have to give up. If you gave up something like related to food, you probably still shouldn't do it on Good Friday. So, everybody totally confused at this point? So, questions? Let's see, what's my next slide? Every year, Pope Francis and Pope Benedict did it, John Paul II did it, and I think it went well beyond that. Every year, the Pope writes a message for Lent. This year, it came out about 3 weeks from yesterday. So if you want to read the whole document, this long link here is where you can find it. But if you're on the computer, if you just type Pope Francis' message for Lent 2017, it will probably come up. If you type for 2016 or 2015, you can get old messages. These are just three quotes I picked out of that. It says, Lent is a new beginning, a path leading to the certain goal of Easter. Somebody said anticipating Easter. The season urgently calls us to conversion. We're trying to change. We're trying to become better. Lent is a favorable season for deepening our spiritual life through the means of sanctification offered by us, the church, for prayer, fasting, prayer, and alms?
Almsgiving.
Lent is a favorable season for opening the doors to all those in need and recognizing them in the face of Christ. Lent is about us changing to become more like Christ calls to, because we look forward, we say, you know, when we think about giving up, you know, sometimes you have to say, I don't really want to give this up. Well, I don't know if Jesus wanted to hang on the cross either, but, you know, if you want to get Jesus off the cross and tell him not to worry about your sins, then you can go do what you want. But that idea of looking forward to that. But it's supposed to change, Lent doesn't just change us from Ash Wednesday to Holy Thursday. Lent should have an effect on us the whole year. Through some of the practices we just do here.
That's why I don't think Lent is year-round as far as the way I believe it. Because if you're going to sacrifice and give up for Lent, that should follow through for the whole year. I mean, you mm-hmm. should change yourself. So we shouldn't put a time that Lent ends.
Mm-hmm. Then you do something new the next week.
Well, say you got a lot of things you know you need to work on in your life, Each year for Lent, you can pick one. Hopefully make that one better the next year. Although you don't have to wait to the next Lent. You could choose to get one tackle to do. But we can't, when we need conversion, if we realize there's a lot of things we need to change in our life, to change them all at once can be a challenge. So each Lent can be a time we, when we know there's more things to work on, okay, what do I want to work on this year? But if they're bad behaviors, we're not supposed to go back to them after. So to move along a little quicker through the next couple questions, because it's cut after 8 now. What don't we sing during Lent?
Why don't we?
Oh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah and glory. The glory, because Lent is a penitential time. We're not supposed to be dancing in the streets and whatnot. Although, if you're familiar with the Eastern Rite churches we have that are in union with the Pope, some of them do still do the Gloria during Lent. The Alleluia, the word Alleluia, I'm not sure this is a literal translation, it means praise the Lord. So that when we, instead of doing Alleluia, we sing some kind of acclamation like praise the Lord,
praise
or something. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ. So we do something like it, but we just don't use that Alleluia. And then during as a way of making us think. And then but we can look forward to when we get to Easter, we sing the Alleluia, and we'll be joyful on it. Not that we're supposed to be visible, but joyful. What's the color for Lent?
Violet.
Technically, it's violet. If you're like me and have no artistic ability, it's purple. I remember one time I was sitting in the confessional for the first Sunday of Advent. Nobody was coming in, so I was reading the rubrics about Advent, and it said, during Advent and Lent we wear violet. But during the season of Advent, we wear violet with a deeper hue of blue in it than we wear in Lent. And I'm like, I don't know what the difference between violet and purple is. And you want me to worry about the hue of blue in it? I'm like, so we wear violet. Do we always use violet in Lent? There is the Sunday that is.
Later.
Get in the right season, you know. The fourth Sunday of Lent is. I have not notes. Yes, it's Lautare. Gaudete is Advent. And it's a time of having some joy. It's still Lent, but to remind us there's something joyful to come with the resurrection. So, we use robes. However, most churches, if you wear the rose, the priest will wear the rose vestment two Sundays a year. And one of those is technically optional, and the other one, if you don't have a rose vestment, you can wear the violet still. So most churches don't have rose vestments. So we kind of forget this. Including the year hasn't had a rose vestment. Hasn't had. We now have one. So when we get to the fourth Sunday of Lent, I will be wearing rose. And to make sure I remember, because I haven't been in a parish in several years that has rose vestments, my phone's going to beep at me at 2 o'clock on that Saturday to remind me to wear the rose vest. But an idea of joy, you know, the rose is kind of a warm color. And it's rose, it's not pink. The reason it's rose and not pink is because the guy's wearing it.
It's a blue hue.
Yeah. I don't know what the difference of what rose looks like versus pink. I just know it's rose because I'm a guy and I'll be wearing it. And guys don't wear pink, right? Although in seminary there was one guy, when we weren't in our collars, would wear a pink shirt much. We let him call it whatever he wanted because he was a little taller than me and he lifted weights. So whatever he wanted to call it, he could wear it. Okay. So what are you doing for Lent? I hope tonight helps you think about why we do things for Lent. You may still do the exact same things you do each year. And some of it, you know, for some, sometimes your kids will have given up candy. And sometimes, for some people, giving up candy is not a big deal. For me, I give up candy as part of my Lent. But it's a huge deal. I have to, I almost have to rearrange my schedule at times not to eat candy. So, if it takes real effort, it's not necessarily a bad thing to give up the Lent. If you can give it up and just you don't really miss it, then you think about that. So, think about what you're giving up. And then the last slide, I'll just put up and take questions. Just a reminder, on March 20th, I'm doing a presentation on navigating the Bible. And then on April 3rd, calling it evangelization and apologetics, how we talk about our faith. With the Bible one, if you're coming and you want to bring your own Bible to ask questions about it, you can. I'm also just placed an order for all of, to be able to have a whole lot of copies, and you could, depending on how many people come, you can take them home if you want. It's a Bible, New American Revised Edition Bible, New American Bible Revised Edition. It's a it was just slightly updated in 2011. But for all to say, it's one that actually has some maps in it and things like that, that it's this box. I'm ordering a whole bunch of them for $13. So if you need a different Bible and you want to see how it fits in with the different things, feel free to bring it that night, but I will have copies. I've ordered 50 of them. Tonight we've got 35 people here or so. We'll have some. But if you want to bring your own and see how they compare. So do remember, please, to do the evaluation, especially with the change in the format, whether or not you like the slides and discussion and all that. With that said, any questions before we break up? Okay. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And if you have any questions you want to ask me individually, please feel free afterwards.